Because I hope you've had an opportunity to grab a drink or a bite to eat and to check out the incredible display from NASA and from the various centers and divisions throughout the library that have a connection to poetry and space exploration. Before we begin, I'd like to give a wonderful and heartfelt thanks to NASA, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and the staff on the Europa Clipper mission for this historic collaboration with the library and the Poet Laureate. Carl Sagan famously said, "Imagination will often carry us to the worlds that never were, but without it, we go nowhere." And the Library of Congress is the home of the Carl Sagan papers. And through our collections and programs, we encourage people to broaden their minds, expand their imaginations, and to cultivate their passions. Libraries are at the intersection of the... So let me tell you a little bit about the Poet Laureate position at the Library of Congress. It was created in 1937, thanks to a generous gift from Archer Huntington, and it was renamed by an act of Congress in 1985 by reading her own work and by taking on projects and initiatives. That is why it is a great honor for me to welcome the 24th Poet Laureate of the United States tonight, brilliant and talented Ada Lamont.
Pleasure and honor it is to be with you all here tonight. It has been the greatest honor and privilege of my life to be asked to write a poem that will be engraved on the Europa Clipper spacecraft and the launch in 2024 to go to the second moon of Jupiter, Europa. And when I was asked to write this poem, I celebrated for exactly 20 seconds. And then I proceeded to freak out. And really, it has been the poem, a true human endeavor. And I'm very excited to share it with you today, the unveiling. In praise, the night sky, inky with black expansiveness, we point to the
quick wishes on stars. From Earth, we read the sky as if it is an unerring book of the universe, expert and evident. Still, our mysteries below our sky, the whale song, the songbirds sing in the unshaken tree. We are creatures of constant awe, curious at beauty, leaf at blossom, at grief and pleasure, sun and shadow. And it is not darkness that unites us, not the cold distance of water. Each drop of rain, each rivulet, each pulse, each vein, oh, second moon, we too.
Grief and pleasure, sun and shadow. And it is not darkness that unites us,
not the cold distant, each pulse, each vein. O second moon, we too are made of water, of vast and beckoning seas. We too are all invisible worlds of a need to call out through the dark.
Was that cool or what? Oh my goodness. So much has happened since we were last together on this stage over 6 months ago.
I know.
Could you tell us about your first term?
Yeah. You know, this has been a very exceptional year. and when I stood on the stage with you in September, I never could have guessed where all of this would lead. And so, as you know, I've been to the White House many times.
Many times. State dinner.
Is doing this NASA collaboration with the Library of Congress and NASA. It's been really beautiful.
You're taking poetry up to space, and it's wonderful. So tell us a little bit about your time at the White House. We all want to know, because she's been in, what, 3-4 times? They call up and say, is the poet laureate available? We're having a state dinner, and we thought, because the First Lady,
yeah,
Dr. Biden, really connected with you.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that the first time I met Dr. Biden, I thought, I went to her team and I said, how do you refer to her? And they said, well, she will tell you to call her Jill. And I said, well, that's not going to happen. So what do you say? They said, we call her Dr. B. I said, okay, I can do that. But I still, of course, when I met her, I said, well, Dr. Biden, you know, nice to meet you. Words for. We've connected in numerous ways, but I think really she is a true lover of literature. As you know. So that has been delightful. And one of the trips in September, we were invited to the Hispanic Heritage Celebration in the White House. And when we arrived, like my husband and I often do, you've met my lovely, beautiful husband, there was President Biden and Dr. Biden, and then suddenly Dr. Biden started reading my poem, Dead Stars, which, interestingly enough, has the line in it that says, that's talking about pointing to the stars. What would happen, you know, if we, you know, if we launched our demands into the So yeah, it's been a real honor to be there.
So you've been busy with other parts of the federal government, and now that's why we're here tonight. So how did this happen with the connection with NASA and all of that?
And the Office of Communication immediately set up a call, and we were in the Office of Communications. I was here in the library, and we all gathered around Brett's office, and we met with NASA, and the Zoom call was so interesting because they just kept telling us this about this marvelous mission, the Europa Clipper, and you know, like all, you know, all about Europa. It was like, am I gonna have to go?
Uh-huh. We would have supported you. First poet laureate in space. We can still do that. Watch it. It can happen. So then, but then you understood, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and it was a moment where we got off the call, and they said, you know, and we got off, and we were like, oh my gosh, we're going to go. This is amazing. And everyone was still celebrating, and I just was like, oh no. I now have to write a poem that will be, and at this point, I actually didn't know it would be engraved on the side of the spacecraft.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I'm actually kind of glad I didn't know that. There were some things that was good to hide from my brain when I was writing the poem.
So you spent, I understand, some time in Hawaii mm-hmm. at the former home of another poet laureate yeah. as you were writing this. So tell us about that.
Yeah, the poet laureate, the 19th poet laureate, W.S. Merwin, and he had created a 20-acre palm forest in this beautiful, beautiful, all you know, hand planting these palm trees. And I thought, well, this is where I will go write the poem. And as I was in this beautiful space, I kept thinking, okay, very seriously, I wrote every single day. I would write a new draft every day. And I would, you know, I kept reading them to my husband. And my husband finally said, I think you need to stop writing a NASA poem. And it was such wisdom. And I immediately got annoyed because he's always right. And I said, yeah. He said, you need to write a you poem. You need to write a poem that you would write. And it really changed everything. And I went back to the drawing board. I scrapped everything. And there was one line that I had originally written actually during the Zoom call. And that line was the one that survived. But yeah, I went and created a whole new poem, and that's what I was like, oh, he's right. I need to write a poem that I would write, that I want to write, and not keep thinking about the audience and keep thinking about that. But I had to shut some of that out.
Yeah, that was, and did you know that it was going to be on the side of the thing?
Not yet.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, it was very good.
You were still flowing. You were still doing that.
Yeah.
And then you went to visit the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in your home state of California. Now, what was that like?
Yeah, and I remember when they set it up, they were like, well, would you be interested in going? And I was like, yes, of course, I want to see this. And we had this amazing time there. The team, the whole Clipper team and the JPL team are just really generous and kind and really took us through how it was being built. And we went to see it being built in the clean room.
Whoa, the clean room.
Yeah, it was really remarkable.
I liked it.
And we went to Mission Control. You know, it was like really fascinating and incredible.
Were you kind of wondering, wait a minute, they're showing me Mission Control. Were you still wondering, or is it just the poem that's going on?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, because we have a video clip, from what I understand, of your time there to show.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's NASA we have.
This explains binary numbers. They figured that if we could talk to them, it would be the language of science.
This is very JPL because it's this just perfect intersection of creativity and total nerdiness.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exploration and, you know, poetry, art, words can both transport us, right? They like explode our imaginations in the best possible way.
And almost always we begin in questions. And we end it in more questions.
Right?
It doesn't end in an answer. And I feel like exploration is similar.
Engineers in this room are responsible for monitoring and maintaining the data flow. And since 1964, that data has been delivered to this room. That's why we call it the center of the universe. What do you think of
it? I love it.
I kept returning to this being a human endeavor, too, and Earth endeavor, right? Like there's this, the level of that connection, that it's not just about out there, but also here. And that had to be
beautiful.
So what was it like to meet the scientists that were behind this?
Incredible. I kept asking them more about, you know, so it says there's all the ingredients for life. What does that mean? You know, all these things. And one of my favorite parts about talking to the scientists there is that, you know what they wanted to talk about? Poetry.
Good.
You know, and they were like, how do you make a poem? You know? It was really great.
There's a science to that, too, in a different way.
Yeah.
And they could understand what you have to do to produce what you do.
Yeah. And that idea of curiosity and, you know, how you make something, and also the idea of, again, beginning in questions and ending in questions, you know, that it's not about finding one ultimate answer, but instead existing in wonder.
Existing in wonder. Well, we have a special treat because we have someone that will tell us more about the mission behind the poem and how all of you can be part of it. So I'd like to welcome to the stage Dr. Nicola Fox, who is an associate administrator Dr. Fox is the associate administrator of NASA Space Mission Directorate, and she said we could call her Dr. Nikki.
You just call me Nikki.
Nikki.
Yeah.
So it's just wonderful. And so, well, tell us about that directorate and how your role began.
Oh, the Science Mission Directorate is just a wonderful place. We do, you know, little tiny goals, things like, you know, protecting, you know.
It's all in a day's work.
Or in other words, Monday.
Yes. Wow. Neat. Neat. Well, now what about the Europa Clipper mission in particular now?
Yes, yeah, so the directorate is made up of wonderful scientists. We have six different divisions. I'm going to talk about planetary science because that is the home of the Europa Clipper mission. But the planetary science, studying all of the planets and moons in our solar system. Astrophysics, looking beyond our solar system into other galaxies and telling us about life elsewhere. We have biological and physical sciences that actually study, you know, how we adapt and survive in space, and how we can better our food here, and how things can be adaptable when we want to send our long duration missions to Mars and even beyond. We have our Earth Science Division, which of course is looking after our home planet and telling us, you know, about climate and about how we can better protect our planet. We have heliophysics that studies the sun and everything that the sun touches. And then we have another division, joint agency satellite division, that does all our partnerships with NOAA. And literally these divisions work together to do those really lofty goals that I started with. We also work really closely with the other mission directorates. We work closely with our exploration partners, with our humans in space partners, with our aeronautics, with technology. So as we now venture off the Earth, back to have a sustained presence at the Moon and then on to Mars, we go together. We go with science enabling exploration and exploration enabling science. And exploration is the heart of the Europa Clipper mission. So we are going to journey out to the icy moon, so beautifully described in your poem, that Jupiter's icy moon. We'll travel, we'll do about, I'm going to give the number even though I've been told it was iffy, 49 passes of the moon, and we're actually going to be looking for sort of signatures of things that could sustain life. So, you know, we do think that Europa Europa is probably, after Earth, the most likely place to actually be suitable to sustain life. Yes. It is not a life detection mission, but it is going to...
Just let us go.
I had to put that in there. It's going to look for the conditions that would sustain life you were talking about. So water, energy, the sustainability, just that things that actually could sustain life. So Europa Clipper, super, super exciting mission. Made even more exciting because we're going to have a poem on the side of it.
You sure are. All right. That's going to be so cool. But you've also launched something that I understand you call Message in a Bottle.
Yes.
So tell us about that and how we can all do it, because we might want to go up there.
Well, we'd love you to all come with us. So Message in a Bottle is a boundaries and let more people just come and experience the excitement of science. You know, you don't need a PhD to be a scientist. You just need to love asking questions. You have to be curious and you want to know more about the world around you, the universe around you, the solar system around you. You just need to know, want to know more. And so we want to actually invite people to come with us. So not only will this beautiful poem be engraved on the side and a chip on that will be put on the spacecraft, but we actually invite everybody to send your names in to us and we will engrave your names on a chip. So you will come on, I think it's something like 1.8 billion mile journey with us to just, you know, explore the regions around you. And it's a beautiful partnership. So it's between the Library of Congress, of course, our poet laureate, NASA, the Jet Propulsion Lab, and it's got lots of different facets. So we're sort of kicking it off today, and with, of course, the reading of the poem, it kind of kicks it off. But it's really bringing together two different places, a watery moon so far away from us with Earth, bringing together these two different things. And this campaign just lets us bring together untapped people who've never really experienced science before. And so do you guys want to know how you can join the campaign?
We have a video. And this is, I have to tell you, this collaboration with NASA is just super cool. They know, the video. We have a video. NASA produced.
Here's how you can get involved in NASA's Message in a Bottle campaign and read and add your name to U.S. Poet Laureate Ada Limón's poem for Europa. Go to your preferred web browser and type in go.nasa.gov/message-in-a-bottle. Click the Send Your Name button. Read the poem or listen to the poem being read by U.S. Poet Laureate Ada Limón. Enter your name and fill out your information. Click the Sign On button. And congratulations. Your name will be submitted to travel over 1.8 billion miles, along with the poem, to Europa on NASA's Europa Clipper spacecraft. Once you're done, you'll receive a custom piece of artwork that you can download, print, and share with your friends and family.
All right. Isn't that so? That's marvelous.
Pretty cool. And it's you know, that's only a little part of the campaign. We'll be doing sort of campaign integration with the Library of Congress website, social media, ongoing outreach. So you think it's cool that NASA's partnering with you. We think it's cool you're partnering with us.
Oh,
so,
well,
awesome
thank
job.
You. Well, in 2000, the Library of Congress launched the John W. Kluge Center to bring scholars from around the world to connect with our collections. And just over a decade later, the library and NASA's astrobiology program created the Baruch S. Bloomberg, NASA Library of Congress Chair in Astrobiology. I feel smart just saying that. Oh, exploration and scientific innovation. For a scholar working to understand and bring understanding to the interface between human society and scientific exploration of the cosmos. And for the last part of our conversation, I'm very pleased to welcome our current chair, Dr. Sherry Wells Jensen. And just in full disclosure, I have to tell you that Dr. Wells Jensen has another project that they told us do not start and mention, so we should have known that I was going to do it. Water, but that we'll talk about that if we have time. But Dr. Jensen, I'd like to start with you because we are going to have a conversation with him.
That's a really good question because honestly, from some perspectives, we don't honestly have to, right? We've got this beautifully constructed machine here. It could go out on its own, it knows how to do things, it could perform all the experiments, it could do the analysis, it could just boom, be on its merry way back to Earth, no problem, or wherever it's gonna go. It doesn't need us. But at its heart, the thing that we're doing here, that search for the potential of life, is not just a set of experiments. It's not there be anything else. Do we have to be the only ones? Is there any potential for life, right? Mm-hmm. And so this is living things reaching out for the potential of other living things. Mm-hmm. And it's so deeply important. And honestly, every deeply important human endeavor begins with some kind of greeting. Mm-hmm. So there are 7,000 languages in the world, and all the languages have words for things like sun, moon, and water, and all those kinds of things. But they also all have dozens and dozens of words for greeting one another, for ways of saying hello, and ways of saying you're welcome here, and here's my name, and can we be okay? Mm-hmm. And for example, what Dr. did so graciously to begin this whole event was exactly that, right? She greeted everybody. Mm-hmm. She bid everybody welcome. Important, gather here, come, connect with one another, give everyone an understanding of why we're here. And she offered us her name, just like your names are all mm-hmm. going to go to space mm-hmm. because your names are as mm-hmm. right? It's the beginning of a relationship. And We aren't going to have any maybe measurable relationship between us and little pieces of goo or, you know, hunks of water, whatever the heck gloriously and interesting nerdy things we find on your own. But that's still the urge to connect is so important, and we want so much to say things. And so it's not so much that we need to hear back, but we need to send the message because the message itself is it's nestled so deeply in the essence of who we are. It's impossible for us to do anything important without sort of putting a greeting on it before mm-hmm. we send it off. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, at the library, we have a history of sending messages, and you can find more about those instructions. And in fact, tonight, we had displayed one of the gold-plated copper discs called Sounds of the Earth, but more commonly referred to as Golden Records from the Voyager space mission. And we have an image of that. So, Dr. Fox, can you tell us a little bit more about these efforts and how NASA understands them?
Yeah, the Voyager, the two Voyager spacecraft, the Voyager mission, you know, launched in 1977 and still going strong.
Image of that. So, Dr. Fox, can you tell us a little bit more about these efforts and how NASA understands them?
Yeah, the Voyager, the two Voyager spacecraft, the Voyager mission, you know, launched in 1977 and still going strong. It just beautiful. They just turned 45. Yeah.
Yay, for the little Voyager.
They had their 45th birthday last December, and it's just incredible stuff. You know, bringing us really the first views with Voyager 1, the first views of Jupiter and Saturn, you know, really inspiring missions like the Europa Clipper. You know, we've seen these amazing two going past Uranus and Neptune. You may have seen those beautiful James Webb telescope images recently of Uranus and Neptune, just giving us unprecedented views of them. And, you know, of course, in the planetary decadal, a mission to go to Uranus is one of the big recommendations. So just really inspiring us. But then they transitioned, you know, they did their big planet tour, and then they transitioned and became heliophysics missions, actually giving us information about the outer reaches of our solar system. So, you know, beyond Pluto, way, way out there, actually crossing into interstellar space. And so Voyager 1 crossed in August of 2012. Voyager 2 went in November of 2018, crossing in very different locations, going outside into interstellar space. So basically, into the region where they're no longer protected by the sun and the stellar space. Yay, sun. And they're in this sort of region where they're, it's like, you know, all the sort of all the stars that have died and have remnants, and they're in that interstellar region, and they're still going, and they're still sending back data, thanks to our deep space network. Mm. They're still spending out. There we go.
Uh oh.
NASA in the house.
Uh oh.
Yeah. You've got a geeky audience when you get a cheer for
I know.
Space.
I know. So we're just working on behalf of NASA to the renowned folklorist Alan Lomax about gathering the music for the Golden Records. And we have an image of that letter, and Sagan writes, "We believe that public availability of a two-record album identical in content with the flight record will stimulate listeners to examine our civilization and culture and consider how we wish to be represented to the cosmos." Mm. In addition, it may be for many music. So, with that example and that hope that we consider how we wish to be represented to the cosmos, what do you think poetry offers as a message from Earth and a reflection of who we are, that we are sending poetry? Mm. Well, Ada, you know what? Want you to
I thought, I was like, that would be great.
Think about it. Think about it.
I was really getting is deeply human, and that it, as opposed to music and as opposed to some of the other different things that we've sent, one of the things that poetry does is it has to include everything. Right? The music is in the poem. The bass line is in the poem, it's in the repetition. Everything is in the poem. It has to be complete on its own. And so what I love about it, I love the Golden Record, so this is nothing against the Golden Record. Don't at me, Voyager.
You almost.
It just has to be there, and it includes everything. And it includes human breath. When you read a poem and when you experience a poem, you're walking into someone else's breath. You're understanding how that line break, caesura, whatever is working in the poem, is part of that human connection. So that's one of the things that I find really moving about it.
And Dr. Wells Jensen, in terms of a message that you would send, or how you think we should...
I think it's really important to clarify, but water is it's essentially a different substance here because of the purposes and the appreciation that we have for it. It's a different thing. And so if we're going out looking for water there, we should think about what water is here and acknowledge and celebrate the difference between those two things, because the difference is meaningful. And the difference between water there and water here is the addition of all the living things on Earth. Mm. It's a whole different thing. Mm.
before we wrap up, I mean, I tell you, I had to get an injection of creativity, brilliance to sit here with these ladies today. You should know that. But we head home to the U.S. Copyright Office, and all of Ada's poetry collections are copyrighted. But for the first time, she's copyrighted just a poem. And so here to present a certificate of copyright. It's very official now. For In Praise of Mystery, George.
Thank you. Beautiful.
The Roni.
Beautiful. Thank you so much.
And George is our Deputy Director of the Office of Public Information and Education for the U.S. Copyright, and he's so delighted to be able to present that. Very cool. You're really official now. So, and finally, we want to leave you with one more experience of Ada's poem, thanks to our friends at NASA's Europa Clipper mission. And we have something special to show you.
In Praise of Mystery, a poem for Europa. Arching under the night sky, inky with black expansiveness, we point to the planets we know. We pin quick wishes on stars. From Earth, we read the sky as if it is an unerring book of the universe, expert and evident. Still, there are mysteries below our sky. The whale song, the songbird singing its call in the bough of a wind-shaken tree. We are creatures of constant awe. Curious at beauty, at leaf and blossom, at grief and pleasure, sun and shadow. And it is not darkness that unites us, not the cold distance of space, but the offering of water. Each drop of rain, each rivulet, each pulse, each vein. Oh, second moon, we too are made of water, of vast and beckoning seas. We too are made of wonders, of great and ordinary loves, of small invisible worlds, of a need to call out through the dark.
Thanks again to this amazing stage of presenters, our Librarian of Congress, Dr. Carla Hayden. Our U.S. Poet Laureate, Ada Limón. And our special guests, Dr. Nicola Fox and Dr. Sherry Wells Jensen. I'm Rob Casper, Head of Poetry and Literature at the Library of Congress, and I want to tell you again that you can sign up for the Message in a Bottle campaign at go.nasa.gov/messageinabottle. So please do. You can also go to lsu.gov to learn more about the Poet Laureate and the Library of Congress. And for those of you here in the audience, we hope you come back. The Jefferson Building is open late each Thursday night for programs and exhibits such as this, as well as happy hour drinks and food. Thanks so much, and have a good night.
Christina Cook. I'm a mission specialist.
I'm Jeremy Hansen. I'm a mission